are lethal weapons. Their one purpose, the sole reason for their existence, is to knock enemy planes out of the sky. They are P-38s, and they rank with the fastest and best fighters in the air today. Now, the fact that this is a two-engine airplane does not mean that it's a difficult airplane to fly. On the other hand, the two engines do give it a wide range of performance and extra margins of safety. Some hangar experts insist that it is impossible to bail out of the 38 because of the twin booms and rudders and because of the horizontal stabilizer span. The truth is that it is no easier or harder to bail out of the 38 than out of any single-seater fighter. Bailouts can be made either, one, by turning the plane on its back and dropping out, or two, by getting out the left window and sliding down the wing. Now, don't stand on the wing to jump. The span of the horizontal stabilizer just doesn't affect the bailout. At high speeds, the airflow carries any object straight back and under the empennage, which is actually higher than the wing. Therefore, the only portion of the empennage which is critical is that portion directly aft of the bailout area. Thus, it doesn't matter whether the empennage has a 20-foot span or a 100-foot span. The critical area is still the same. Furthermore, on the 38, there's no vertical stabilizer which can get in the way. Actually, however, the object isn't to bail out of your ship, but to make the other fellow bail out of his. In the 38, you have a weapon which will help you do just that. It's a fighting man's airplane. Tough, rugged, reliable. Its high-speed performance is well known. But its control at low speeds is equally spectacular from the point of view of performance. Presented herewith is a new type of airplane, a primary trainer escort, under absolute control at 90 miles an hour indicated. Now, watch its acceleration. Most important of all, maximum performance makes it possible for a 38 pilot to dictate when and at what altitude he shall combat. But to achieve that maximum performance, it is first necessary to understand normal and emergency operations. What we're about to see won't give us any laughs or thrills. But in the thick of battle, when the going is tough, might mean the difference between victory or defeat, life or death. Among other things, we'll see what to do for normal routine precautions. For single engine flight, landing, and single-engine failure on takeoff. How to handle one or both propellers inoperative, or so-called running wild. We will check on use of landing gear and flap emergency extension system. All of these will be seen for the purpose of achieving the true objective of the airplane, maximum performance in combat. And the men best qualified to demonstrate these operations are the men who know the 38 best. Men who have flown them the most, production pilots. Charlie Brannan. Tom Kennedy. Jimmy Mattern. Avery Black. The pilot who's flown more 38s than any other man is going to take it up from here. He's the chief engineering test pilot, Milo Burcham.
We're not going to try to teach you how to fly. You've all had good training in other ships. We're simply going to show you how we handle a 38, hoping to increase your knowledge and skill, and in that way, add to the effectiveness of the ship and to your own safety. There are certain routine precautions which apply to every condition on every flight. So let's take a look at those right off the bat. Before takeoff, the hatch must always be securely latched. Both sliding windows must also be closed all the way. With the windows closed, the airflow is normal. But if the windows are carelessly left open, the airflow is disturbed and causes the wake to hit the tail. On airplanes equipped with external tanks, it is essential to be able to drop the tanks immediately in case of engine failure on takeoff. Therefore, before starting, the drop tank switch is placed in the safe position, and the drop tank selectors are placed on, so that in an emergency, we can lose the tanks by simply punching the drop tank release button. When the full fuel load is carried, takeoffs are always on the front tanks. Normally, we use no flaps. Later, we will check on conditions where flaps are used. But at all times, maximum allowable manifold pressure is used. Once in position at the head of the line, and after run-up and mag check, propellers are checked in the automatic position. By trying the governors, we make certain that they're really governing. Booster pumps are switched on in order to ensure adequate fuel pressure in the event of engine fuel pump failure. Brakes are held while both throttles are advanced to get the maximum allowable manifold pressure. In this case, 40 inches. The object is to get those turbos turning so as to obtain takeoff power at the start of the takeoff run. Furthermore, by holding the brakes as long as possible, we allow the propellers to reach the governing limit of 3,000 RPM at the start of the run. And that way, if they're going to run wild, they'll do it while there's still time to stop the ship. Now, without flaps and using 40 inches of manifold pressure, the 38 starts the takeoff run. Because of the tricycle gear, however, there is no tendency on the part of the airplane to fly itself. Therefore, at about 70 miles an hour, we start to ease back on the stick. At 90 to 100 indicated, after a run of 15 to 1800 feet, we pull back to break ground. At this point, in spite of the lack of a feeling of lightness, the airplane responds immediately and easily. Gear is upped as soon as the ship is committed to flight. By the time the gear retracts, indicated airspeed will be at least 150, well above single engine operation speed of 120. If the boom doors do not close immediately, nosing the plane abruptly down a couple of times usually will close the doors. No flaps are used for normal takeoff because without them, we get the single engine flying speed faster. But if this tower, for instance, were an obstacle 1,700 feet from the head of the runway, a zero flap takeoff would catch it right amidships. With 50% flaps under exactly the same conditions, the airplane easily clears the tower. Airspeed will be at least 140 indicated by the time the gear retracts, which is enough speed to retract the flaps without loss of altitude. Although flaps reduce takeoff run about 500 feet, they only provide a takeoff goose because the rate of climb and speed at zero flaps quickly exceed the initial advantage with flaps. As soon as the airplane is in its climb, power is reduced to 37 inches of manifold pressure and 2,600 RPM. At this time, if high altitude flight is not contemplated, booster pumps can be turned off. There's very little difference in the rate of climb at indicated speeds of 140 to 180 because what is gained by the angle increase is lost in speed.